So this is a very major this thing which we had in the in this stream of Leo. One of the very major work was for the active phased array. Similarly, there has been cases, especially once we know that a phased array has got a very good application. So we went in for various other cases also where we can give a phased array. In fact, in this communication satellite, we have a requirement of this thing, meteorological data to come. That is called, we call it as VHRR, that is very high resolution radio meter, from which every day you see the cloud picture which you see in the TV, it comes from a satellite. And there normally we use traditionally a dish antenna is used, and dish antenna weighs not less than 3.5 to 4 kg even for a 1 meter dish. So we wanted to replace in one of the satellite called METSAT. The satellite was launched using a PSLV vehicle, not GSLV, because the satellite weight was less, just about a 110 class. We wanted to launch in a PSLV which can take to the geo transfer orbit, and from there we can go. But the weight has to be limited to 1 kg. So everywhere we want to reduce the weight. So here in this case, instead of that 3.5 or 4 kg antenna of this one, we made a microstrip array. This is here, there is no complications as per what we saw in the fixed array. Here only it is a geostationary antenna satellite, simply one fixed beam is required. So what we did is we made a simple passive array where no variations are there. Simple passive array which will directly give the beam. That's what we made, and that passive array is made out of microstrip. And one of the simplest thing is microstrip, where you can see only the this is required. You see, this is the microstrip array which we made. As you can see, this is the array. These are the mounting area. You have to give some area location for the mechanical engineer to mount. Otherwise, how he will mount the antenna? So these are the areas wherever there is no patch. Nearby you give some area for them to mount, and this is the full antenna. This is a microstrip antenna, you can see number of subarrays are made, and this is made, and totally the full antenna gives about 25 dB gain, and this is being used in the METSAT, which is now on the space in the this. So far, see, you see the pattern, how beautiful it is. You see almost 40 dB cyclo, 40 dB cross pole. In fact, this is the first antenna which we measured in our compact antenna test facility, because the compact antenna test facility, they said it can measure cross pole of the order of 40 dB and better. To make sure that we can get that sort of thing, we also have to have an antenna which will give you 40 dB cycle, 40 dB cross pole. In fact, that luckily this was being developed at the time, and this became the first antenna to be tested in the compact antenna test facility which we have in Bangalore. Similarly, we made different thing at K band, also we made a 32x32 planar array. This was required for one of the India coverage. You must have heard Mr. Rajiv Jyoti talking about the dish and the shaped beam antennas which was used using a reflector technology. Here in this case, same thing, but we have used a phased array technology to get the shaping. We know this is India. India, if you want to cover it in total, we require about 4.5 degrees. So here we have covered using that this one. Here you use the phased array technology instead of a normal dish. This is the contour of the same thing which I showed. How does the phased array work here? This is the phased array. This is for downlink, this is for uplink. Uplink is always higher frequency, because Ku uplink is about 14 GHz. Ku downlink is about 11.7. 11.7 to 12.2 is Ku downlink. 14 to 14.4 is uplink. So this is the size, much smaller, and this is a slight bigger. But the whole thing we have built in a single platform using the microstrip array, and to have the required bandwidth. Here the bandwidth is 500 MHz or more. How do we get the bandwidth? So we require a honeycomb sandwich, where the honeycomb material is a armored fiber, and its dielectric constant is hardly 1.1. And we can have different thickness so that we get the required bandwidth. So a reasonable good thickness, at the same time the surface wave don't come into picture, that also is there, plus the required bandwidth. Right, this is what was made, and we got the antenna pattern as I showed you earlier. In this case, we need to get this contour of this nature. This is an alternative to that, but this particular one we are not close, because the KE band are not, because many of them require much higher power. So this we have not really flown, but the development is complete for any of the next thing to go. See, this is the one. Actually, what we did is, when we made, here also we have populated area. But we found the mechanical engineer, when he wants to mount, there is no place for him. So, but how do we do it without mounting it? So, what we did is, when the analysis, we found the elements which are present here. See, they wanted mounting at the edges. So, these two edges, if you want to give, we have to remove a lot of elements. So, when we remove that element, we wanted to know, now we know that it is necessary for us to mount. And if you want to mount, we cannot have the element there. So, we removed that element and then did the simulation. Then we found that it is the edge elements, you know, which are, see, from here when you come to the edge elements, the amount of this thing reaching there, signal reaching there, is very less. So, we found the effect of this is not much on the actual antenna pattern. So, we removed this. Then we also found that the one which is there here also is not affecting much. And then this particular area also, once these two are not there, we thought this also may not be required. So, all these three together we removed this diagram. We removed this and then saw it in the simulation and found they are not affecting much. Maybe if you put that, it will be slightly better, but it is not affecting much. So, all these areas were given to the mechanical engineer to mount. See, the engineering we had to do, that's why, because otherwise how the antenna needs to be mounted very firmly and then it has to withstand the required vibration. So, we have to have it.
Can we take up other structural so that those areas which are aged out, mechanical support or other circuit components can be utilized in that area, and it will give this type of pattern.
Yeah, yeah. Different. Actually, here only thing is the gain requirement is quite high.
This array, what Sal is showing, this can be generated in a fractal.
Yes, yes.
So that is,
but what is here, the gain requirement is there. Gain.
How much gain, sir, you believe?
No, no. Normally, see, this is the full, here you can see.
Full array.
Okay, this is full. Normally they will look for a ARP of the order of 35, 36, 40, 45, 47. Again, it depends on what sort of PWD you use. See, the TWT you use, you can have a 60 watt UWP, you can have a 140 watt UWTA. It depends on what sort of TWT that this thing will be there. But this antenna gain plus that they will finally set the goal with respect to the ARP. With respect to that ARP, we had apportioned between the antenna gain and the TWT. TWT, any TWT field like is not available, so we have to tune to whatever TWT is available, then mechanically design the gain of it. That is okay. So, this is the actual final antenna fixing, this is the antenna, and this is the mounting structure. This is whole thing is mounted on a structure to make, so just do the work. After that, this will be removed, and only this is a honeycomb structure on which the spacecraft will be, the spacecraft interface under that. So, directly see, spacecraft, all the spacecraft panels are made out of honeycomb. Honeycomb has got an excellent property. So, the honeycomb is very lightweight, at the same time strength-wise and other things are very good. So, the honeycomb panels are used. So, directly the antenna is fixed onto the honeycomb panel. And the fabrication-wise also is very simple. It is only a PCB. We make this out of two different PCBs. One PCB for this uplink, one PCB for downlink. These two together are nicely bonded using vacuum baking. What we can do is, the whole thing you can put in a vacuum bag, put it into autoclave and nicely cure them. It will be beautifully, it will cure. Nicely, once it is cured, it becomes a single integrated antenna. And you can use the required dielectric. You can use a special foam dielectrics are available which are replaced qualified. And the honeycomb structure also is used. And the whole thing is fixed onto, this is a spacecraft panel. This is just we took a spacecraft panel simulation so that we want to make sure that after fixing onto that panel we are getting the required pattern. So that is how the whole thing is done for a KVP antenna array. This is also used for the X-band. These are all alternative to the dish antennas which Mr. Rajiv Jyoti was servicing. So the phase array has got a very major, this is the antenna pattern. You can see, as you say, what is the ARP? The ARP here is about 29.9, this gain. See here, it keeps varying. 29, 27, 28, 30, etc. It keeps varying. So, it depends on how you want to cover. Suppose you want to cover only portions which doesn't cover the side. This one, now if you do, what happens is your northeast is not covered. Then the next beam, if you go, northeast is partially covered, but the Jammu and Kashmir is not fully covered. Then, if you want to go to further one, then only you cover both. This blue one only covers both northeast in almost in total plus Jammu and Kashmir. But still, your portions of Assam is northeast still left out. So, you have to go in for next. Suppose you say for geostationary orbit, geostationary orbit only has to travel large distance, you know. the power not only from the ground is of the order of 3 kilowatts. 3 kilowatts of power.
And from satellite to the
Earth? From satellite is normally much less. Satellite for TTC, TTC is of the order of 4 to 5 watts of power. Whereas, I mean, not 5 and sometimes even 1 watt of power, depending on the this one. But for the this payload operations, what we see is the transponder, C-band or KV-band transponder, they will have a traveling wave tube, TWT, which will be 60 watt or 140 kilowatt, 140 watts. See, normally we are using, or it could be some 35 watts. So depending on the requirement on the ARP, we use different tubes. And accordingly, once the tube sizes are known, we will have the size of the antenna. Normally, size of the antenna is of the order of 2 meters. 1.5 to 2 meters, you must have heard about it yesterday last time. So, this is the size of the antenna we use. And then, depending on the frequency, we can find out what is the ARP we will get. Depending on what tube you are using and what antenna you are using and what is the gain. So, that is how we determine. From the ground, actually the 3 kilowatts of power is what is available. Generally, they will use hardly of the order of 750 watts or so. Hardly they will use 750 watts. Because that is the link is sufficient for that.
And so for antenna modeling and simulation, do you use the standard simulation softwares like HFSS or do you go for the computational techniques?
See, for dish, for reflector antennas, they use a software called Tikra. It's a very famous software. Or Tikra. The whole world uses. It's a superb software with which you can make a full reflector analysis using that. It's an excellent software available, and this is a must for a reflected antenna designer. It's a must. Otherwise, he can do on his own, but he has to write all the this one. But normally now, since the commercially it is available, people use it. And if you want to import all these antennas, you know, any antenna you import will be not less than 10 crores. Not less than 10 crores. It will be much more than that. Any antenna of this class, if you want to import, this is some 40 lakhs or so. So, you in one antenna design, you have taken the cost. Now, if you take, see, Rajiv Jyoti, you can, so many antennas he has made, all contoured beams. See, India is like this, you know. If you make a Gaussian beam, what will happen? It will be just simply like a circle. It will be a circle. Lot of energy will be wasted in the sea. So we have to contour the beam. So if you want to contour the beam, you require this one, contour beam antenna. How can you do a contour? You can do a contour using the reflector surface, or you can have the array. In the array, you control the coefficients in such a way that you get a contoured beam on the base. So these are the two options available to you. So the reflector designer will use the reflector, contour it in such a way that you get the required beam. Or if you have a phased array man, a phased array antenna engineer will use the phased array to get the contoured beam. So there are two different technologies available. We saw both. You saw the contoured beam technology which Mr. Rajiv Jyoti has told you that day, using the reflector. And here just now I showed you the phased array technology which can be used for contouring this.
Is there any specialized computational technique like finite element method or something like that?
Actually, HFSS is basically a finite element method. HFSS is a very good. See, there are so many other elements which you need to design. No? So all those all waveguide elements which are required, you use HFSS, or you can use HFSS is one of the major thing you can use. And then nowadays there are other things. No, there are CST studio is there. Apart from that, now for filters, they use one specific software. So, we can have different types of beams. So, we thought at least of 8 beams are there, you can reasonably cover the Indian land masses much better. So, this is one more study was made. So, we find that if you have 8 beams spaced like this, we will be able to cover most of the India. So, what we did is, and then, but 8 beams means we should have, the adjacent beams should be of different frequencies. See, within the bandwidth, say if I take 11 points, whatever be the frequency, we should make sure that the adjacent beams don't have the same frequency. So, this is how the frequency selection will be. So, here you can see the engineer has done that frequency F1 and F1, next to F1 we are using, it should be the third beam. So, that the roll off from here to here is met. similarly from this side to that side. Otherwise, if you put F1 here itself, these two will directly interfere. Here also from this, it can interfere to this, but it will be much lesser extent because the roll off is quite a bit at this point. So F1 you can use here. Say F4 is used here, F4 is used here, F2 is used in these two, F3 is used in these two. So four different frequencies is used to generate 8 beams. And with these 8 beams, you see now we are recently covering everywhere. See here, this is main distinctly South beam, this is distinctly almost Jammu and Kashmir, this is almost for UP and parts of Bihar, and this is Bengal and Oriya. This will go to Northeast, this will go to Gujarat and Maharashtra, this will go to Karnataka and Madhya Pradesh, this will Andhra Pradesh, mostly Andhra Pradesh and parts of Oriya, and this will be distinctly Tamil Nadu and Kerala. So this way, in between gaps are all taken care by these beams, either by this beam or that beam, depending on which is advantageous to that particular area. So accordingly, the frequency can be allotted to them. So this is how the whole things have been done. Actually, this is made as a conceptual study for regenerative payload. In fact, in our next satellite, which is going to be launched in June, July, there is a just called GSAT-4, where we have a regenerative payload, where the normally you would have seen in multimedia, this thing, there is a hub. The hub station will decide when the caller party calls the satellite, the hub station will decide whether the party is a genuine party and he is a member, etc., and what frequency to be allotted to him and then get back. So the processing all comes from the this thing before the called party can locate the party which he has called. So the full processing is done on board. So since it is done on board, it is called a regenerative payload. That is, it can do the demodulation as well as do some processing and get back to the ground. So the hub is totally knocked off. See, knocking off of the hub is a very, very great cost effective system. Very great cost effectiveness, isn't it? Because the number of hubs which you will require throughout the world is quite a bit. So if you don't have, especially if you take only for India, the hub stations are not required. Everything can be done at spacecraft and directly you can contact from one end to another end. It is so great. So that is how this has become a very popular scheme. And this is one of the payloads are going to be there in our GSAT-4 satellite, which will be launched in June, July from our, actually this will go into our GSLV satellite rocket, which will have an indigenous cryo. The indigenous cryo development is almost complete. Now they are doing the final assembly of the stage, and the whole thing will come to Sriharikota by this summer, and we will launch in around June the full satellite. The satellite is named as GSAT-4, and that will carry this will be operating in carbon, KM, 26 to 40 gigahertz. It will operate in carbon, that is this one in this, and the antenna size, etc. But here, in this particular case, they are using a different type of technology. They are not a 5-phase array. In this first one, they will use a segmented reflector. That I think yesterday he must have talked about, a segmented reflector, with which you will be able to generate all the beams. Later we can go to the phased array also. See, once this is over, for further this thing we can go for this. But it can be done. But in this particular case also, the generation has been done, even though this is the generation has been done using a reflector with multiple fields. Here what it is, this is not shape. This is we use multiple fields here, not one single field, so that you can generate beams at different directions. On this, you can offset the field in such a way that you can get the beam in the required direction. See here, this is the actual beam. See, for each one beam, to see how the beam gets generated and what will be the this thing on to the next, not the second beam, the third beam. So it should be better than some, say this itself is 17 dB down. So when it comes to this beam, it will be much lesser. So that's to show the beam to beam isolation. First to second beam, it doesn't require isolation because they are at different frequency. First to third beam is not as isolation is required. So to see how that it is done, the engineer has generated the beam to show from analysis. All these things you can do using the graph. See, this is the spacing, the location of the feed elements on the focal plane, because we wanted to generate different and also the antenna needs to be tracked. So for tracking purpose, monopole tracking has been fixed, and that is also fixed here. So the whole system is a very complex feed network, and that has been done, and of course it has not been thrown in. This is one design which is available, and we may use it in one of the future satellites. That is, both you can track, at the same time you can have the multiple beam generation. See, this is the element you can see. A large helical element you can see here. See here, this dielectric is extended more because the space available is very less. you cannot have a flare in this direction. So the engineer has was done it. He has used a directive extending a very large size. The directive is extending to very large size. So that all the 8 elements can be accommodated within that small area. Otherwise, you could have had one of the easiest thing is to have a horn, but that will occupy a large area. So this is a special design which is done. And these are all cave and cob and this is waveguide elements. So this one when he has made that it is being tested on the compact antenna test facility. You can see the this is the positioning system of the compact antenna test facility where it can rotate, you can move in this. There are two slide motion, one to this X, Y, and then from here if you take on top, we have an azimuth over elevation position. So we can do the elevation movement as well as azimuth movement, as well as the this if you want to rotate the polarization axis, that also can be rotated. So the whole thing can be controlled by using a computer outside. There is a controller outside, and this particular one is supplied by a company called Orbit. It is a very famous company for positioning systems. So this is how it is mounted. You can see this is the reflector. This is the this one, and this facility when we built up in the compact antenna test facility, that was when we built in 2001-2005. That was the best facility available in the world. Now actually there is a facility which is slightly bigger than this, they have built over the years. But at that time in 2001 we built, this was the best facility available in the world. See, this is the antenna pattern. You will see the second one because the yes, plotted for both 20 gigahertz and 30 gigahertz. See, 20 gigahertz is slightly bigger, 30 gigahertz is smaller. So economy is how the all the beams are covered. So very nicely, full India is covered by these 8 beams. So that you can have different programs, you know, you can have programs for different locations, whatever program they want. And nowadays with the type of technology available, we don't require a full transponder bandwidth for our TV channel. Look at much smaller bandwidth. We can have it because of the advent of technology, things are much better now. So we can have more and more channels pumped into one. Previously we required minimum 36 MHz bandwidth to transmit a normal analog channel in that. Now it is not required. Now with the digital channels coming up, much more number of channels can be. This is how the whole thing looks like. Actually what we do is we make it like a hexagon first, and then this hexagon we will put a inscribing circuit with which you will know the beams. Then obviously of course when you do that, I told this only this thing, we require number of filters when you do the antennas. When you use single antenna for multiple frequencies, you require number of diplexes. Especially in this particular case for S band, we use only single antenna for TTC. So we require a diplexer. So what we do is all these diplexer assemblies we put in single phase. We find these are the two filters. These filters are normally we use a comb line filters, which will give you a very good this thing. Very, very good response. These are two our comb line filters, and this is a network which will bifurcate between the transmitter and receive frequencies. And this is some divider, this is a switch, and this whole thing is mounted in a single plate so that from here directly can connect to the antenna. So this is a nice interface between the transmit receiver and the antenna. So we call it as a S-band diplexer, which is used. This is used in all our space labs. See the how the diplexer, when you see the two patterns, one is for transmit, one is for receive frequency. When we are receive frequency, the transmit frequency should have a very low the rejection should be very large. So we can measure here, this almost from here you can see it is completely merged into the noise. See, some of the things which you want to see is the ground system measurements also. Here also basically we take off from what we have been doing for that. I will quickly go through some of the things. We had an airborne SAR. This is our SAR. So SAR is a synthetic aperture radar. So for some DRDO, they wanted a SAR antenna to be made. So as a project for DRDO, we made a synthetic aperture radar. But this particular one is a pre-run to that. This did not fly in spacecraft. This we made for our own airborne applications for ISRO. So for that, this we made out of a makeshift for it, and this was used for SAR application. See here, in this particular case, the requirement was like this. This was the type of pattern required. So accordingly, the phased array antenna, this thing, the element excitation has been made in such a way that you get a pattern of this nature. This is the frequency band, it was in 3 to 3.4. And then based on that one, later, when DRDO approached us for this thing, ultra-low solid low it's called ALSA, ultra-low solid low variant. So that technology could be used. And we had made a large phased array because normally for ultra low side lobe antenna, normally they use only a slotted array. So in this particular case, we wanted to use a microstrip array and then show them that this is also a technology which can be used. And finally, we made one very large ultra low side lobe antenna and it was given to the DRDO for their testing.
What is the exact material used for SAR?
Which one? This one? Here. This is as far as the antenna is concerned, it is a simple microstrip antenna. And to take care of the large frequency, this one power which is required, what we do is in the feeding network, we had different feeding. We had a wave, we can see here, initial stages we had waveguide network. Then further down the next level, we had a square X line. Square X line is nothing but a coaxial line where the this one is a square section. The normally coaxial line will have this, you know, and the center conductor. Here, in this case, what we do is on that plate, you make like a square section. And then put a center conductor, hold this center conductor using some Teflon beads. So if you see the section, this will be a Teflon, the center conductor will be running and you will have some Teflon beads which will hold that. So that is called a square X line. So first level when the power is very high, you use the waveguide section. Next level you use a square X section. Then by the time the power is already very low, then you go to the microstrip line. So that is how we got the large power. And here in this one, you know, these are all used for radar. So they will all be pulsed systems. So the power requirement will be, of course, overall the power requirement is very high, but even then the power is not a continuous power.
So is it processor plus stack antenna system or slicing the software system?
No, here we are not used, in this particular one. This was done more than 15 years back. We are not gone for sliced, this is SPA, this one here.
Here it is only a full array, always the feeding is done by different layers.
One I said first this one is top one is the microstrip, next one is a square X, third one is the waveguide. So that it can take away.
So this is a full antenna array, you can see.
To measure this was a great challenge because here we have ultra low side lobe means almost 40 dB side lobe need to be measured. So for that measurement, one thing is what we did is one method was to use an air fill measurement. At that time we didn't have an air fill measurement which can take care of this around size. So we had to go in for a far field range. So for far field range, normally this 2D square by lambda we take, we cannot measure the side lobe of the order of 40 dB and all. It is not possible to measure. So we had to go for a much longer range. So when we calculated it has to be of the for this particular frequency, we required more than 1 kilometer distance, 1.2 kilometer distance to measure the required side lobe. So what we did is in this particular case, we had from our location in Bangalore, from our office, actually those days the airport was quite close and there we approached Airport Authority of India to allow us to put up a transmitting antenna at their side. So they agreed because it is meant for government to government, it is not a problem. So that they allowed us to put a tower there. So from 1.2 kilometer distance, we transmitted from there and received here to make sure that we are able to measure that 40 dB side lobe. Those days we didn't have our compact antenna test facility and other things were not available. So we used this first time between airport, old airport to our ISRO satellite center. We used this thing. That was about, aerial distance was about 1.2, 1.3 kilometers. So with that we could measure the large side lobe which was required for this. So this required an ultra low side lobe. See here, this is the antenna pattern, you can see, it is almost a 40 dB was our scale, you see, you can see, almost at some 38 dB could be. Apart from that, for our ground station, we require number of ground antenna to be, antenna systems to be made. So the majorly they will be dish antennas, the heart of the system as you know is the feed elements. So all these feed elements, it can be S-curve because we want the data is at X-band, TDC is in S-band. So we require single field which can take care of both. So this type of S-class antennas have been made and they were all given to different types of dishes, 7.5, 11 meters. One is for C, one is for S-class C, one for S-class S, L-class C. So different these things have been made and given to the ground station. So all those things are all spin-offs from our experience and experience in the design of antennas. For this, all these things are existing either in Bangalore or in, say like X-class S is in NRSA Hyderabad. 11 meter dish is also is in S cross C, this is in Hassan, this will be in C band stations are all in Hassan, and S band, X band stations are all in this. So these are various antenna configurations. How do you make? So here we have to have a monopulse tracking. So the elements are made and separately, and we get a pattern. So you see the sum and difference pattern. You see the difference pattern is so sharp. See, in tracking, this is very important that your difference pattern has to be very sharp, so that even if you are slightly away from the target, you will get the error built up, so that the servo can respond and immediately get back to the target. It's a very important thing. So the null pattern is what is very, very important. So if you get a very deep null, then you will get a very good. So that difference pattern you can generate using the system here. This is being tested. Actually, there is a full-fledged antenna test facility at outdoor range. A large test range is available in a place called Sona. I was told it is some 100 kilometers from Delhi, or about 30-40 minutes drive from Delhi. I don't know, I have not gone myself. But this normally when we give it to our NRSA, they themselves will go there and do the test. So for this is separately, feed is separately done, dish is fabricated elsewhere. The two things are integrated together and then they do a test before they install in their place. So normally this test is done by, actually it is at, it belongs to Bell Ghaziabad. But they in turn allow ISRO or any other people who wanted to do the test. So this test is being done at Sona. This is the measured pattern. See, this is in between when we do the assembly, this photograph there. See here, you can see the pattern, no? So beautiful it is made, but this is some pattern, this is a difference pattern, how deep it goes. Even if you are slightly off the target, you see completely the difference pattern will come down so much. It will show you what is the error. See, the error which it will generate will depend on what sort of this thing you have. Similarly, we have done for the dual shaped reflector antennas. So all different types, all these things are coming because of our this thing on the experience on the various technologies we have developed for onboard. So these are all spin-offs for the ground systems. Then in between we had one requirement from Inmarsat, those days from International Maritime Satellite Communication, to develop a handheld antenna system for a satellite telephone. So they wanted a very, normally S-band, the size will be of the order of 50 mm or more if you want to use. They wanted a very sleek and small antenna which can be used along with the satellite handheld phone. So this was, there was a, they asked for many companies to quote, and we also quoted for this, and finally we got the contract to do first a study and after study a hardware. So the whole thing we did, and this is the size of the antenna which we have used. One is for uplink and other is for downlink, and this is can be, this is only a model of the handheld set those days. Now people will laugh if you give this size. This was done about 15 years back. 15 years back we could imagine that this would be the size of the handset, and accordingly this was made. Now neither the antenna size is acceptable nor the this was available, but at that time when the first study was made, this was a very useful one. So this we made and then got into a, we got a the patent also for this type of antenna for being made, and this was given to the Inmarsat for the this is only to show how the testing is being done. Same thing, this is a C cross X field which we have a station at Bayak in Indonesia where we have the this is there we have the antennas. Then the other one is the 32 meter dish which we did for the Chandrayaan. See, this is the deep space network which is there on the station at near Bangalore. It is about 40 kilometers away from Bangalore. We have the deep space network where we have this one. This is generated, this is the field system. We have used a beam waveguide for this so that we require large number of reflecting elements here, because otherwise the regular waveguides and other things you use, the loss will be more. So that is why we went in for a beam waveguide, and this is the reflector, and that is the hyperbolic structure. The whole antenna fabrication after design has been given to ECIL Hyderabad to make that design, and they have done the total missing design, because after the electrical design, the mechanical design is extremely complicated, because the mechanical design including the wind velocity requirement, this one etc., you see the backup structure and other things are extremely complicated. So once you give the profile,
the mechanical engineers have done their excellent job, and then the whole thing has been installed, and with this we are able to use this. Here you can see this. This is the one. From here you come to this reflector. From here you go here, this will get deflected and go here, get here, again reflected and go back. This is a very complicated beam blade waveguide structure, and all these elements, the mirrors, let it be a parabolic mirror, a hyperbolic mirror, or any other one which will be made, we got it done at a very precision fabrication work place, either at Hyderabad or at Godrej in Bombay. Godrej in Bombay did very good work in some of the very precision mechanical work which is required for the beam blade waveguide. See, this is one of the dichroic plates because we wanted X band as well as S band. S band is for receiving the telemetry and the command, for receiving telemetry and then command sending, whereas for X band is for receiving the data from the space. So we required to bifurcate the two. That bifurcation is doing then using a dichroic plate. This is the dichroic plate which is fabricated in India in Godrej. And this is a design effect, and here this white ones are all those Teflon patches, so that the effectively that aperture can be more. For it looks like smaller, but it will affect the aperture will be more than an air dielectric. So that is how this full thing is made. It's a very mechanically it's a very challenging work, but electrical design is okay, but mechanically it's a very challenging work. It has been done by Godrej, and this dichroic plate is being used in our deep space network as one of the feed elements for the beam delivery. See, this is how the pattern looks like. For two different frequencies it comes up, and the basic horn, this feed element is the corrugated horn, because corrugated horn has got excellent symmetry in both the planes. So corrugated horn, and also has got a very large bandwidth. So this is a master antenna, which I would say. This corrugated horn along with the full gamut of both the parabolic elements, dichroic plate, hyperbolic element, depending on where you want to deflect and take it, they were all been designed separately, and we have made the units ready. See, this is the ray tracing, I can say, you know, how it happens. From this is the basic horn from which it goes to one dichroic plate. From that it goes, it gets deflected, again goes there, gets deflected, goes to this, and this is the secondary reflector. And this parabolic hyperbolic reflector has got because when you move this large antenna in elevation, what happens is that some deformation takes place because of the gravity. So for that purpose, this needs to be small adjustment. Then this has got an adjustment in all the four axes, and then yet a table is generated. So depending on the location, various locations are determined and it is fixed. So that is a mechanically, I would say electrical design is difficult already, but I find mechanically it's a great challenging work which was done by this. In fact, there are many industries which were there along with ESAL. One of the major other players was Bark, and so many other industries, mechanical industries, have contributed. And the electrical, of course, basic electrical design is from ISRO Satellite Center. This is also an artistic view of how the BSM is here. This is a secondary pattern, and that is how finally we made it, and this gave